Hey, Maranatha family, Pastor Daniel here, and I'm so bummed I'm not able to be with you in person today, but don't worry, you guys are in great hands. My good friend Evan Wickham is going to be bringing the word to us this morning. He pastors a great church in Point Loma called Park Hill Chapel. His dad, John, is one of our worship leaders here on staff. His brother Phil, another great worship leader. So will you guys join me in giving a great, big, warm Maranatha welcome to Evan Wickham.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Hey, Maranatha Chapel family. It's so good to be with you this weekend. When Pastor Daniel invited me to come preach on this weekend, it was like an easy yes. You know, 27 summers ago, I was in 10th grade, and my dad, who you saw standing here just now, he answered the call of God with my mom to come down and be a pastor here at the church. 27 years of faithfulness, still here serving Jesus. So, I met my wife Sandy around that time in high school, and she and I have led worship here a bunch. First time not leading worship here, but preaching. So, hopefully that's okay. But I have three sons here. They're in the 1, 2, 3, 5th row there. So this feels like coming home in many ways, and I'm told today is Communion Sunday. Y'all have your cups with your bread and juice. So we are going to be eating and drinking the bread and cup of Jesus together with, the stats now are like 2.56 billion people who in some way confess Christ as Lord all over the world. So we're all going to join in this meal. Over 2.5 billion people that look to this bread and this cup in virtually every culture in the world, unified around Christ in this meal that we're going to eat today. So we're going to receive the body into our bodies as the body of Christ globally. So it's really profound what's about to happen here. So which is why today I want to talk about what happened. Something happened at that first Communion meal, that Last Supper. And what happened in that room, a lot of things happened in that room. Many of you know the story of the Last Supper, but there's something that happened. It's seemingly insignificant at first, but it's profound in its implications, this one moment. And so it's all about this idea of leaning back into Jesus's body. So this happens in this room at this meal, and I want it to happen here for all of us. We all want this to happen who follow Jesus. So here's the plan. We're going to read the story, and we're going to pray that the Holy Spirit opens our minds to the beauty of Jesus, and then we'll walk through the text, make some observations for this church, and then we'll do what they do in the story, lean back on Jesus and eat and drink of him. So here we go. We're going to read the text first. Grab your Bibles, John 13, verse 21 through 30, 10 verses. A ton is going on in this text. So here we go. John 13, starting in verse 21. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, "Very truly I tell you, one of you is going to betray me." His disciples stared at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, "Ask him which one he means." Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It's the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I've dipped it in the dish." Then dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. So Jesus told him, "What you're about to do, do quickly." But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the festival or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, breathe out your Holy Spirit, we ask. May your presence be known here so that we can see Jesus rightly. Remove any false visions of God that are in our heads. Replace them with the true vision of Jesus. The lion who is the lamb who is slain and who invites us into the family of God by his own blood. May we lean onto his body today. May we know what that means. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so let's start here. So who here has heard the term lean in? Like lean into your career, lean into your five-year plan or your degree program or whatever. So for the last 10 years or so, this idea of leaning in, taking up space, crush it in the workplace, get to email inbox zero, you know, this idea of lean in has dominated more and more leadership books, right? More and more conversations around business and management. So the idea is to produce more, control outcomes, get to like inbox zero. It's a really, we can laugh about this, but we also feel this. I think we feel this pressure. Pressure to expand our careers. Or gosh, I should really be more networked by this time. I thought I'd be more networked. Or I really need to get that five-year plan outlined in, otherwise today I'd matter more, you know. So we lean into our relationships. Even as a pastor, I lean into like ministry goals and personal development. Or maybe you're feeling I gotta lean into starting a family soon. I'm gonna otherwise I'm missing out. I gotta have something going on in my life. I gotta lean in. And now it's summer, so we're all leaning into those vacation plans, you know, and so that we can get rested and then lean into the fall. It's a cycle. So and this is the grind that we're in. And even kids are feeling this, even our kids. So in 2011, the Pew Research Survey Center, they found out 64% of Americans say that parents aren't putting enough pressure on their kids to get better grades in school. Okay, poor kids. So now the kids are feeling the lean-in pressure too. Men, women, children, all of us, we feel this drive. Don't get me wrong, I do think it's important, you know, to do hard things, take risks, be challenged, all of that. But with the entire American cultural river pulling us to live our lives leaning in, the Gospel of John comes to us with a vivid picture of what discipleship to Jesus looks like against the grain of our frantic culture, and that is to lean back. And this is what we see in John 13. It's the night of Jesus' betrayal, the night Jesus would die for the sins of the world. And Jesus is enjoying the Last Supper meal with his disciples, what would be the first communion meal. And after dinner, you know the story, Jesus removes his outer garment. He kneels down to wash the disciples' feet, which was an act reserved for slaves in that day. And so after the foot washing, they're all lingering around the table with Jesus. And the atmosphere of this table is important. What do you picture in your mind when you think of the Last Supper table? A lot of us immediately go to the Da Vinci, whatever. You know, I don't know about this. Like, question for Leo Da Vinci. Like, it's a 26-seat table. Why everybody on one side? I don't know. That doesn't seem right, but it looks good. So you've got this image. I'd say most humans think of this image when we think of the Last Supper because of this amazing piece of art. But the table would have looked more like this. A U-shaped table, cushions on the ground, no chairs, low to the ground. Next slide, too. You can see some folks have just guessed where they may have been sitting based on the dialogue in the narrative. You have John leaning up against Jesus, and Judas is close enough to receive the bread, and then Peter shouts across, hey, John, tell Jesus, ask Jesus this question for me. So that's just an artist's rendition. And then in the last slide, you can see it. You got to have some CG. So there's some CG for you. So you have more of an intimate thing. U-shaped, no chairs. They would have been leaning on their left elbow since the right hand was used for eating and drinking. I got to eat a meal like this in Saudi Arabia a decade ago. I was on a mission trip, and we sat down on the ground, and the waiters had these epic scimitars, and we had to lean, we had to lay down and lean on each other. It was very small and very on the ground, and so it's different. You go to dinner today with someone, and you can like hide your phone under the table or hide your knees. No hiding anything in this. Very present to each other, very intimate. So this is the vibe. So Jesus and his 12 closest friends are here, sitting, reclining, and Jesus, he starts to explain how one of his brothers in the room is about to betray him. Someone right here, you have the bread and cup, you have the cups in your seats. One of you is going to betray him right now. And the room gets very tense. And you thought your Thanksgiving dinner with your family is awkward. This is tense in this moment. So Judas sitting there, and Judas is sitting there, hearing that hatred in his heart, tired of Jesus' teachings, tired of Jesus' promises that look nothing like the promises he wishes Jesus would make. Sick of Jesus' way and even Jesus' life, and so Judas finally agrees to help get rid of Judas. Judas is plotting to betray Jesus, and Jesus knows this. It's clear that Jesus knows this. One writer says this about betrayal. Betrayal is more than separation or rejection. To betray is to use the secrets of a person's personal life, thoughts confided to a friend, and to turn against that person, to use their confided thought or words in order to hurt and defile them, to destroy a reputation. Maybe you're here and you know this feeling. Judas did this to Jesus, the Jesus we just worshiped, the Lamb. Hallelujah, the Lamb of the Lord God Almighty. Agnus Dei is the name of that song we just sang. Judas betrayed that Lamb. Judas knew his secrets. Judas knew Jesus' thoughts. Get this, Judas even knew Jesus' location and that Jesus wouldn't fight back. And so Jesus, during this meal, he's no longer able to contain his emotion. And he says this in verse 21. Jesus just starts exploding with emotion and he's troubled in spirit. That's a deep anguish in the Greek. It's a very emotional word. His guts are turning over and he says, "Very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me." And so it's like Jesus can't contain this. Have you ever been there when you can't emotionally contain a piece of information? You're with loved ones and you have to just spew it out because of your grief or your excitement. And the disciples are shattered by this revelation. The text says they're at a loss. They're just completely perplexed. It's surreal. It's a bad dream. And maybe they're not so much perplexed by the words Jesus said, but by the way Jesus would have said it. So probably trembling. Jesus' voice is quivering through the tears. Listen, Jesus is not the glazed over sage. One of you will betray me. He's not just emotionless, static. No, he is shaken to his core right now. So much so that he's freaking his disciples out. You know, like, you know that look that little kids get when they see their dad have an emotional breakdown? Maybe you've seen this as a child. This is the disciples right now seeing the epicenter of safety. Their leader, their big brother Jesus, who is the Messiah. They're realizing he's the Son of God and he's breaking down. And so in this moment, Judas leaves the room in this weird exchange. So Jesus is like, "My betrayer is the one to whom I will give this dipped bread." And then he goes, "Here you go, Judas." And everyone's just like slow motion, bad dream. What is happening? Right? They're not processing. And when Judas finally leaves the room, John, the writer of this gospel, he makes this comment. He says, "As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out and it was night." Why does John add, "and it was night"? Because it was night. First reason. Silly joke. But there's actually a narrative reason. John loves to play with light and dark. John loves to play with opposites in his gospel. He does this in the beginning of the book. If you know John's gospel, you know the beginning. It says, "In Jesus, in him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome the light." So John's playing with these opposites, light, day, light, dark, day and night. And he does this a lot in this gospel. And so here, when Jesus, who's the light of the world, gets betrayed, John comments, "And this is night." This is what John is saying intentionally. He's making this contrast. Why? Because Judas was turning away from the light of the world and stepping into the deepest darkness and the coldest place any human has ever known. Judas was rejecting Jesus' love, absolute tragedy. So here's a little chart of how Judas' tragedy unfolds. Starts in chapter 6, where Judas loses trust in Jesus. And then chapter 12, Judas directly opposes Jesus. And then in chapters 13 and 18, you see Judas outright rejecting Jesus' love with betrayal. And then from this point on, no light can come into Judas anymore. He's in darkness, you guys. And in darkness, you can make some of the worst decisions a human being can ever make. This is the dark tragedy of rejecting the light of Jesus. Okay? But during this dark scene, we're given another pair of opposites, another contrast to the darkness that Judas is in. And he is this nameless disciple. We don't get his name in John. We don't get his name. We're only told, hey, I'm the disciple Jesus loves. That's how he identifies, the disciple beloved of Jesus. So you get the binary. You get the opposites. Judas is plotting betrayal. There's a disciple who is the beloved, literally leaning back into Jesus' chest, who's close to Christ in warm fellowship and intimacy and trust and comfort. In fact, the text almost makes it look like this disciple gets closest to Jesus as Jesus confesses his agony. It's almost like this disciple feels Jesus' heart breaking, and in that moment, feeling his heart breaking, this disciple leans back more into Jesus in loving intimacy. And like I said, the disciple's never named. It just says, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Historically, we know this with almost certainty that this is John, the writer of the Gospel of John. But I love what Ronald Rollheiser says about this. He's an incredible writer on the Gospels. And he says, the name is left blank so that every one of us can put our names there. Each of us is to be the beloved disciple, the one identified by leaning back into Jesus in special intimacy. So you're supposed to read the Gospel. This is how John writes his Gospel. You're supposed to read it, and every time you come to the disciple whom Jesus loved, it is a insert your name here moment where you are to say, I want to live as this guy. I want to be this close to Jesus. I want to be identified by Christ's love for me, not anything else. Isn't that amazing, you guys? And this is to contrast Judas. Rejecting Jesus' love, you have the beloved absorbing Jesus' love. One disciple turning his back on Jesus, and another disciple literally leaning his back into Jesus' breastbone. And so John is brilliant here, you guys. John, as you can tell, he's kind of an either-or thinker. He's very black and white in some ways. So in this dramatic scene, John is saying there's really only two kinds of disciples. There's only two kinds of disciples. One who's moving away from Jesus' love in more and more rejection, and one who's drawing nearer to Jesus' love in more and more intimacy. And John's asking us, which one are you now? And what's the evidence of your answer? There's two kinds of disciples. Judas was a disciple, and yet look where he's headed. And so this is what John is after. Now, I want us to really meditate on this image of the beloved disciple. So think of the U-shaped table again. They're reclining, no chairs, and John rests, the beloved rests his head on Jesus' chest. Question, what do you hear when you put your head on someone's chest? You can hear their heartbeat, that's right. So think about this moment. The disciple whom Jesus loved is leaning back on Jesus, head on his chest, ear just above Christ's heart, able to hear it beat, able to hear Jesus' cortisol levels increasing and decreasing. Jesus' anguish is increasing his heart rate, and John's right there for it. John might even be regulated by Jesus' heartbeat at this moment. They're so close. Do you see what I'm saying here? This is John's ultimate picture of discipleship. According to John, a true disciple is someone who's leaning back on Jesus' chest, hearing his heartbeat, and from that perspective, looking out at the world. You see this? So leaning on Jesus, feeling Jesus' feelings, and then looking out at the world regulated by Jesus, not regulated by other voices. So you can see things most clearly from there, can't you? So just a family example, personal, my wife Sandy, she wanted to be here today. She was here last night for the service, but today there's, you know, a new, like a young girl who just got, he just came to faith in Christ and asked for my wife to baptize her, so she's there this morning. So it's pretty awesome, I think. But she would have loved to be here with you. She and I have 5 kids, 4 boys and 1 girl. The girl is the 4th. In a row, she's the 4th, and she's 10, and she has always been incredibly physical. Her love language is for sure cuddling and touch and all of that. And so, but just I think in the last year, she's starting to get too cool for school a little bit, and doing a little less cuddling. But for the most part, she's still very, very physically affectionate. And so, all her life, when my wife and I go in for a kiss, like we're in the kitchen and we just start kissing. She is the opposite of the kid who says, ew. She's like, yeah. And she like runs in and wedges herself in between our knees and just wants to be part of the action. She wants to like look out from between our bodies and smile at her brother, smile at the boy, and just kind of be in the middle of the moment. And so this, right, that picture is John's picture of perfect discipleship. Right? It's not just learning information, it's not just memorizing scripture, although that's going to be part of it. It is remaining in the place of leaning back on Jesus and looking at the rest of the chaotic world from that place, tuned into Jesus' heartbeat. So a disciple is one who sees the world with the sound of Jesus' heart in their ear. And this is what I'm still learning, you guys. This is very much not a, I am a pastor and I'm preaching because I've arrived at this. This is what I'm definitely, after years of leaning in, after years of like, I gotta, you know, plant a church in San Diego. We're in our 6th year. What's our vision for year 7? And pushing forward and networking with other leaders in the city. For me, this, I'm still learning that. This is a matter of life and death for me, physically and spiritually. I have to see the world like this disciple does, from a place where I'm close enough to hear Jesus' heart above other hearts. There's so many heartbeats out there, you guys. There's so many voices that would love to shape you to be part of their team. And so I'm speaking as a pastor. So surprise, surprise. Yes, you can lose sight of Jesus even in ministry. I mean, Judas was, how close to Jesus was Judas? 3 years of hearing Jesus' audible voice. Sometimes we think, oh, it'd be so great to hear Jesus' audible voice. I just want Jesus to speak right to my ear. Judas heard him for 3 years. Very close follower of Jesus. And so just a modern case in point, how many times have we heard stories of high-level Christian leaders who have caved into their own egos and started abusing people for money and sex and power at the expense of people? All while really looking godly and saying godly things and writing godly books. It's enough to drive you crazy. But it comes down to this. For me, I've flirted with that trajectory way too many times. It doesn't start by saying, you know what, I'm going to start using people for my own pleasure and my own monetary gain and influence. It doesn't start with a decision like that. It starts with your eyes and ears pressed up against other voices, pressed up against my church. Oh, everybody wants me to be a certain way. I got to keep adapting and pleasing. And their needs, and what I thought the city needs, the kind of church San Diego needs or whatever, or the music industry as a worship leader and as a songwriter, here's the kind of song the church needs. It's got to have this kind of chorus so that everybody sings it and it travels. Or what I thought everyone else wanted. But when you walk in intimacy with Jesus, you come to realize that what a city actually needs are people who are close enough to Jesus, to hear his heart, so that they can lead others there when the church isn't even there. Do you hear that? That's what your families need, that's what your workplace needs, is a you who is so close to Jesus' heartbeat that you know what it sounds like and can say, hey, come listen with me. Come listen to Jesus' heart with me. For me, this is when I'm pressed up against Jesus' chest, leaning back, and from that place, leaning back on Jesus' own body, I can say then to my wife and my kids and my church, hey, everyone, come here. This is where you get perspective. This is where peace is. This is where comfort is. See, the disciple's location is intended to tell you something about him. He's reclining near Jesus' chest, and from there, he's able to see everything else. Now, this is an even bigger deal than that. So let's step back one more level, and then we'll come to communion. But here's the bigger deal. According to John's intro, John's gospel, if you know John's gospel, you know the beginning is massive. Starts with creation, talks about the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Well, look at Jesus' location. It's exactly the same as John's. Look at verse 18, right here on the screen. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who's himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. So see that underlined part? So that underlined part, I actually think it's best captured in the old, just old school King James. I don't read King James Bible normally, but I love, once in a while I get to. And so how many of you guys brought a King James Bible in here with you? You got that bad boy. Yeah, this is King James. Come on. So here it is. You see the word picture from the Greek come through really well in this specific verse in King James. It's right here. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. Okay, now look at John 13, 23, the story we've been looking at. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. It's the same word in Greek there. So King James puts the same word there. So it's a weird word. Obviously, we don't use the word bosom that often. And don't think, you know, body parts. This is the fold of Jesus' garment. Think the folds of a garment. Think the folds of a garment. So picture a kid with, like, Legos in his shirt. You know, like, I don't have enough hands, so I have to, like, scoop them up with my shirt and bring the Legos to my brother's room because I have a bunch of Legos I want to share. He's putting them in the fold of his garment. That's the Greek word there that King James translates bosom. It's the fold of a garment pressed up. This is where John is at the Last Supper meal. He's pressed up, protected by, and folded into Jesus's person, covered and intimate with Jesus. And it's exactly the same picture in the beginning of the gospel. Jesus is folded up in the Father, wrapped up in the Father's love. This is how Jesus and the Father have always been. In the beginning, the Word was with God, in the bosom of the Father. And now, halfway through John's gospel, he's like, now I'm there too. I'm there too. I'm wrapped up in the bosom of Jesus. The reason this is so important is because according to John 1, Jesus being wrapped up in the bosom of the Father is exactly what made Jesus knowable to you, to us, to the world. See what it says? He hath declared him. Being in the bosom of the Father is what declared him. So what does this mean? It means, literally, you being in the bosom of Jesus, you leaning back on Jesus' chest, will be what declares Jesus to your neighbors. It'll be what declares Jesus to the people you want to see, their family members that are far from God, the people you pray for their salvation, the children you want to see come back home to the kingdom of God. You being in the bosom of the Father is the best evangelistic position you can take. And I know this is important for Maranatha Chapel because I went to your website, I found out the first button on the upper left of your screen is literally no God. This is the point. This is the mission. You click on the No God button and you see Daniel. Hi, thanks for clicking on that button. He actually says that. It's very cool. I checked. And the way we say it at our church, Park Hill Church, we were created first and foremost to be with Jesus so that we can become like him and do what he did. Be, become, do by the power of the Spirit. This is it. This is the beginning and ending of discipleship. And from being with Jesus, from resting our head on Jesus' own heart, we then get the perspective and the power both to know God ourselves and to make him known through our lives of intimacy. Yes, this is everything. This is why John makes this the picture of discipleship, being close enough to Jesus to be able to make him known. Intimacy with Jesus reveals God to other people. Okay, so maybe, you know, we're wrapping up. We're coming to kind of the last 5 minutes, and you're like, this is beautiful, but I'm a practical person, maybe. Maybe that's you, which I tend to be that too. What does this look like practically to lean back on Jesus? What does leaning back on Jesus' chest require of me? What does that require of me? And that's a great question. Three things for now, and then we'll come to the bread and cup. I believe with all my heart, leaning back requires, at minimum, number one, you have to show up. You have to show up specifically in prayer. You have to show up for prayer. This is it. So Rollheiser, he says it this way. There's no bad way to pray, and there's no single starting point for prayer. All the great spiritual masters offer only one non-negotiable rule. You have to show up for prayer, and you have to show up regularly. That is level zero, baseline foundation, leaning back on Jesus. It's showing up to pray. How are you praying? How are you praying? Remember, I said John's very binary. There's the disciple who's betraying Jesus, and there's the disciple who's beloved by Jesus. There's only two kinds. Those are the two kinds. And so are you the beloved disciple? If you answer yes, as evidenced by what? The first evidence, you're showing up to pray. I believe that with all my heart. So my wife and I are in our sixth year of planting this church. And one of the main things we've learned in these 6 years, and I think it's this, that I think Christians have this love-hate relationship with prayer. We really do. Like when we're our most honest, like we say prayer is the most important thing in the world while simultaneously never getting around to it. It's just how Christians are. I don't know. It's this thing we do. And so the reality is if Christians don't take everything else off the table to pray, then Christians won't pray. This is how we work. Everything. Why? Why is that? I think it's everything about prayer is everything the enemy and our own flesh kicks against. Because prayer is everything, it contains everything we need to be leaning back on Jesus. And taking his own body and heartbeat and allowing his heartbeat to regulate our anxiety and peace levels. So Maranatha family, show up to pray. Prayer meetings, you have growth groups. I keep hearing about growth groups all weekend. That's amazing. I imagine you pray at those. Go to that and pray at that. And then pray in one-on-ones and pray in small groups, whatever. There's no bad way to pray. You can pray sitting down, standing up, on your knees, out loud in your head, alone in community, worship music in silence, on a walk, or 2:35 a.m. when anxiety wakes you up in the morning about that million things in your head. You can pray then too. There's no bad way to pray. Just show up regularly, show up consistently. And I'll put it very bluntly, and then I'll move to number two. If you are not showing up regularly to pray, you are not leaning back onto Jesus. So leaning back also requires, number two, we gotta put away distraction. This is just pastoral wisdom from experience and from walking with people. A life of leaning back on Jesus is a life that is aggressively limiting our distractions. So again, this is very practical. Imagine, the U-shaped table, the chairs, the cushions, the lingering, the stillness, and suddenly John's leaning there, and it's like, it vibrates in his robe. His phone vibrates, and John's like all the disciples are like, who's that? And no one's owning it. Everyone's no one's owning it. And then finally, John slowly reaches in. Jesus is like, you're going to get that? Because now I'm distracted, you know? So This is funny, but like one thing I've had to practice in my life is I literally, this is just me, I'm not saying you have to do this. I turn my smartphone into a dumb phone. Like there's no browser, there's no social media, there's no apps that go to infinity just because I follow them for infinity. You know, I just keep clicking on random YouTube videos of squirrels or whatever. So this is maybe for you, it's as simple as kind of making a relational covenant with the Holy Spirit and just saying, you know, I, for 1 hour, for my first hour of every day, I'm not going to like pray for an hour or like read a whole book of the Bible for an hour every day. Maybe you do that. That's great. But just don't go to a screen for the first hour. That's it. Like, just regulate according to reality and not digital for 1 hour with the Holy Spirit. That has been like survival for me, the difference between surviving and not. The last thing on this, my friend who's on staff with me at our church, he sent me a video of one pastor who gave a very simple encouragement. It was a 21-day challenge. For 21 days, can you wake up, and the first thing you say when you put your feet on the ground after you kind of roll off of your bedside, put your feet on the ground, and as you place your feet on the ground, for 21 days in a row, just say, "Good morning, Jesus." It sounds trite and childish and small, but you guys, 21 days of saying good morning to Jesus. Talk about regulating according to the Spirit of God. It's beautiful. These are just suggestions underneath the idea. You have to limit distractions. So here's the reality. Being disciples of Jesus in 2023, while the tech industry has made our lives efficient, it has conspired also against depth. We're so attentive to so many little trivial notifications so that we aren't attentive to people or even what's inside of ourselves. So leaning back into Jesus requires showing up in prayer, putting away distractions, maybe turning your phone into a dumb phone that can't do all the smart things. And then finally, number three, and this one's for me something that is taking center stage, and it's you need to release control of your relationship with God to God. And here's what that means. A church this size in a city like San Diego, there's probably a lot of you here who know how to manage stuff. Manage businesses, manage numbers and write code and manage budgets or medicine or even manage whole companies to make them fit your desired goals. And that's a good thing. Our Creator is a God of order, not a God of chaos. So you can follow our God of order by ordering your business unto His glory. That's wonderful. But here's the problem. We're often tempted to treat God the same way. We want to order our spiritual growth goals and set benchmarks for the Holy Spirit in our lives and control the outcomes. We're like, by this time next year, I should have this much more spiritual fruit in my life, which needs to look like 3 more people I'm mentoring and 1 new mentor for myself, or else I'll be discouraged or whatever. Does anyone resonate with that? Like, I need to see the evidence of my own growth, and it will look like this because I say so. This is using God to produce your own transformation. This is trying to manipulate God to bring about the changes you think you need in your life, when what you really need is to release control of your relationship with God back to God. Like, God, even my spiritual growth belongs to you. Even the results of my walk of faith, even those results, are you create them. They're your property. My spiritual fruit, my maturity process, even that's yours. It's not mine to manipulate. So God, I will show up for prayer, absolutely. I'll put away distractions, turn my phone into a dumb phone, whatever. I'll plant the seeds of your word in my soul. I'll water those seeds with basic Christian practice. I'll show up for church. I'll give generously to Maranatha. I'll participate in growth groups. I'll do all the things Christians faithfully have done for centuries and whatever else. But God, you're the one who is growing me. And the results are yours to control, not mine. You guys, this is essential to being a disciple of Jesus. You and I must learn to release control of our relationship with God to God. Jesus uses the picture of a vine. How much do the grapes have a say-so in anything, or the vine at all? Jesus just says, I'm the vine, you're the branches, my Father comes through and prunes, and one plants, one waters, but the Father brings the increase. So what does this take? What is this release control of my spiritual, release control of my fruit making, release control of that to God? What does that take? I think very practically, it takes something Jesus did many times. The Gospels say Jesus did this many times, and it's something that's really hard for us to do because we're the loudest, noisiest generation in the history of humanity, but it takes silence. Jesus would retreat to the lonely places, the desert places, the wilderness, to deal with spiritual warfare, to pray to the Father, to seek discernment from the Spirit. Jesus needed silence. How much more do we? I'm continuing to learn personally the only way to truly stop trying to control my life with God is through the practice of silence and solitude with the Holy Spirit, just like Jesus had to. Ruth Barton says it like this, and this quote gets me, you guys. Ugh. Without the regular experience of being received and loved by God in solitude and silence, we are vulnerable to a kind of leadership that's driven by profound emptiness that we're seeking to fill through performance and achievement. I hate that. I do that. Maybe that's why Judas wanted Jesus gone. Judas couldn't control him. Maybe Judas was driven by that profound emptiness. And he loved being the guy to say, "Aren't we giving to the poor?" He was leaning into that justice and charity work. But when he started to realize Jesus wouldn't bend to his will, Judas decided to get rid of Jesus. The enduring picture of discipleship is leaning back fully on Jesus, showing up in prayer without distraction, releasing control of whatever happens to Jesus. So can you imagine if we really became a churches, Maranatha and Park Hill and every other church, we're just steps away from the rock. In Point Loma, you can literally throw a rock and hit the rock from our church. So what if the rock and Maranatha and all the Calvary Chapels, Assemblies of God, all the Bible churches and Presbyterian and Park Hill and whatever, what if we became churches who listened to Christ's heartbeat and leaned back on each other into Christ's body? And then we look out into the world and process the events of the world from that place. Can you imagine what kind of church our city would see? I think our city would see what pure love looks like, beyond ideology, beyond liberal conservative talking points, beyond the typical noise that makes everybody mad and riled up and the news headlines that raise everyone's cortisol levels, beyond our opinions and other people's opinions of us. And not just our city needs to see that. I think the very divided church of America in California would see a much-needed vision of self-sacrifice beyond our own personal rights and personal comforts. And I think of a church that's leaning back on each other, listening to Christ's heartbeat through prayer and looking out at the world from there. I think of a community that's strong enough to keep our hearts soft when everything in the next election year is going to try to keep our hearts hard. We need to learn how to lean back hard on Christ's heartbeat in 2024. And in our own church, no gossip in the rooms, just gentle praise of everyone in other rooms. Cheering other people's gifts in a culture inspired by jealousy, increased capacity to forgive even when we're the wounded ones. So that's all I got. We're going to sing, and then we're going to eat, and we're going to drink, because this is what Jesus wanted, and he wanted John to do it in him. He wanted John to lean up against himself. So in a time of deep unrest and division, I firmly believe, church, the Gospel of John declares the only way Jesus followers will gain true perspective on what's going on in the world and then have the capacity to do something about it, it won't come from listening to the right political voices or reading the right news feeds. It'll come as we lean back on Jesus' voice. Jesus said, "My sheep know my voice, and it's gentle and lowly in heart." So you lean back on Jesus and then look at the world from there. So hopefully that's helpful. Can we stand? And we're going to sing. We're just going to sing. And I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, we sing now to the God who is revealed in Jesus. We sing now to the Father, Son, and Spirit who've invited us into relationship. Thank you that you invite us to not just see you and know that you are God, but you actually invite us to be known by you and be intimate with you and to feel your heart and to hear your voice. You're a God who speaks and we can hear. That's wild. How high above us are you? Infinitely. And yet you speak in a way we can understand. So teach us what it looks like to listen and to lean. In Jesus' name. Let's go ahead and hold the bread in your hand, just the bread. Open it up and and hold it on your skin, the body of Christ on your body. And think of everything we've said today about Jesus' body. We're about to take his body into our bodies as the body of Christ. This is intimacy. This is why it's called communion. Very intimate. This is what God has always wanted. In the garden, he created Adam, human, Adam and Eve, and walked with them and gave them a blessing and told them to fill the world with his goodness. And we got off track, and then God started pursuing, and it led him to a cross. And here at this meal, Jesus dipped the bread and he gave it to his betrayer. He gave it to the one he knew would hurt him most. And so he does the same for all of us. So here's the bread, and he says, take this and eat this in remembrance of me. So go ahead and eat the bread. Thank you, Jesus. As you go ahead and open the cup. In the same way, Jesus took the cup and he said, this cup is the blood of the new covenant. This is the new covenant in my blood. You guys, he was always planning on being faithful even when we betray him. He was always planning on offering forgiveness and power. This blood is forgiveness. The blood applied is forgiveness for your sins last week. And guess what? The ones next week. So like next month, when you come back to Maranatha's Communion Sunday, there are sins you will have committed that he has included in his forgiveness and given you power to grow, given you power to become the child he sees you be, the beloved disciple. He sees you becoming the beloved disciple, believe it or not. And he has the power in the new covenant for you to do that. It's the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, would you come now as we drink? Fill us with power. Fill us with the healing presence of Jesus as we drink the cup of the new covenant, which is the Spirit writing your law on our hearts. So write your love into our hearts. May we be beacons of love, and may we love one another well. We're committed to it, even though we know we'll break our commitments. We don't want to. So give us the power to be more and more faithful, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. This is my blood, Jesus says. Drink. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you at these final moments. We praise you and give you gratitude that you are a God who invites us not from a distance, but you're closer than the breath leaving our lungs. Yes. You invite us to see that. So we see that now. Let's just lean back onto Jesus right now and sing this song, knowing he's present to you. He's present to you right now.